Well, that's a fine way to introduce myself. Reading one of the more difficult passages in the Gospels, and I don't even know you, and here I am, a hypocrite. Let me introduce myself. My name is David Reinhart. I'm filling in for the Jelniaks, who are the pastors here at Our Savior's, and Pastor Jelniak called, and I said, well, you must really be desperate to be called making this call. I normally teach at UW-Whitewater. I'm in the philosophy and religious studies department. And so, as I'm preaching this morning, I'm sorry, I'll apologize beforehand. It's a little more teaching than preaching, right? So I'll just do the habit that I'm familiar with and teach a little bit this morning. I should also say I'm the spouse of a pastor at Luther Memorial in Belleville, Wisconsin. Elisa, my wife, has been ordained in the LCA for, probably getting close to 20 years. I used to pastor, but for the past 20 years I've been teaching. What do I want to say about the gospel according to Luke chapter 12? First off, I think a little bit of perspective needs to be brought to understanding what's happening here and why Luke is bringing these two stories and really giving them to us at this point in his gospel. We should recognize, and this is the year in the lectionary when Luke is our gospel. I'm sure you've been hearing mostly from Luke this year. But we should recognize a little bit of how Luke and the book of Acts are organized. Some of us maybe don't recognize or realize that Luke and Acts were more or less volumes 1 and volume 2 in a series. And we have the same author and the same kind of organization, which is, it's not so much a chronological organization as it's a geographic kind of organization. Luke is organizing these stories about Jesus, and Jesus is telling them as he travels from the north down through the south at Jerusalem. And so as Jesus begins, he announces his ministry. His ministry in some ways is compared and contrasted with the work and life of his cousin John the Baptist. And Luke wants us to see that relationship and the arrest and eventual execution of John the Baptist to some extent propels Jesus to begin his march to Jerusalem. And as Jesus gets closer and closer to Jerusalem, the conflict and the intensity of what Jesus is saying gets stronger and stronger. The book of Acts, just to say a very quick word, organizes in a similar way, but instead of traveling to Jerusalem, it's organized as the early church begins in Jerusalem and eventually makes its way further and further west to the city of Rome. Luke picks in our passage today a parable and a teaching that are placed elsewhere in other gospels. And so this is also an opportunity for us to recognize that Luke, not only does he have his own style and approach to telling the gospel, but Luke probably has a Mark manuscript and a Matthew manuscript in front of him as he's putting these things together. He borrows a little bit from Mark here, and he borrows a little bit from Matthew. Luke, throughout the gospel, wants to emphasize two at least two main traditions that go back to the Old Testament. And I think we see both of those in this passage this morning. The first that I'll call the priestly tradition, and the second I will call the prophetic tradition. And that goes back to what we would call the Old Testament. In Luke's time, the Old Testament was still coming together, it was in process. But Jesus quotes a lot from the books of Isaiah, from Psalms, and so we know there are certain books of our Old Testament that Jesus would have had very much memorized, the way that maybe some of us memorize movies or songs or different events. The people of that day would have had these books more or less committed to memory. So when Jesus says some of these things, people recognize them right off. It's as if I said, knock, knock.
Who's there?
You would say,
who's there?
Right? It's such a, so much a part of who we are. Everybody knows knock, knock jokes. And we know exactly how to respond to them. And we know, you know, what they are about. Luke here is quoting from the priestly tradition and the prophetic tradition, and I think the early church would have recognized this. What do I mean by the priestly tradition? Well, sometimes I think of the Bible sort of like a wedding cake. There are the sort of early layers and then more intermediate layers, and then there's the top layer. And sometimes I think of the Gospels as being that top layer. Luther says that the Bible is really the manger in which the Christ child lays his head. Right? The purpose for the Bible is to give us Jesus in gospel message. And the four Gospels that are very diverse and have different approaches and different ideas in them are brought together in the cross. Right? The story of the cross, the story of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus is the pinnacle, the point of those four gospels. So in that top layer of the wedding cake, we have an affirmation of unity in the cross, but diversity of perspective. Right? There's a great appreciation of diversity at the core of Christianity. Think about how Christianity is maybe unique in some ways in that approach. But that bottom layer of the wedding cake, or at least one of the bottom layers, I would recognize as being what we might call the priestly tradition. The tradition of it comes when King David and King Solomon and Israel, the southern and northern kingdom had yet to be divided, and in Jerusalem was David's temple. And in that temple were the priests. And the priests would offer sacrifice, they would say their prayers, and in that worship of God would be the unity of the people affirmed. Right? And so we call that this morning that priestly tradition that in some ways is still happening in Jerusalem in the time and life of Jesus. Right? He's on his way to Jerusalem. He will arrive there during the high point of the temple rituals and organization, right? The Passover. And the priests certainly have an important role to play in that. So there's a priestly tradition of the Old Testament that would affirm the unity of the nation, to some extent the monarchy of the kings, and the centrality of the temple, and the holiness of God. And then there's another tradition, let's say this is the next layer up on that wedding cake after the priestly tradition, and that is the prophetic task. prophets, of course, came at the different points of the early nation of Israel. And the prophetic perspective was very much almost opposite of the priesthood. If the priestly tradition represents the insiders at the temple, the prophetic tradition represents the outsiders. The prophets came to say that there is no justice at the gates. And until there is justice at the gates of Jerusalem, then Jerusalem and the kingdom are doomed. In fact, the end is near. And the prophets were not affirmers of unity. They were really speaking for those voices, for the voiceless, for the marginalized, for the people at the gates of the city. The prophets, although, again, they were all very different, lived at different times, they had a phrase that they shared. And that phrase was, there must be justice at the gates. Well, where were the gates? What does that mean, justice at the gates? It gives us a sense of what the prophetic past really was about. The gate was the place where you entered the city and where you left the city. It was, in a lot of ways, the key intersection, had the most traffic going in and going out of the gates as the city was surrounded by walls. And if you were an outsider, the gates are where you would go to ask for assistance. If you were sick, if you were a widow and needed help, if you were in any way destitute, you lost everything, you would go to the gates of the city, and that's where you would request help. So the prophets are saying that until there is justice at the gates of the city, until the kingdom of Israel and the temple structure recognizes its purpose, then the kingdom is doomed, right? That there will be this rift between the haves and the have-nots. And that's the prophetic task, to speak to that reality. So the priestly task and the prophetic task are very different. And in the Old Testament, it's not so much a contract as it is a conversation. But it is less politely, it is an argument. What is it that God would have us be and do as the people of God? Pray in the temple. Take care of the poor. When Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, in some of the questions that he is asked by some of the religious authorities of the day, to some extent they're asking him to take sides in this argument. But Luke tells us today that the response that Jesus gives is not pro-priest or pro-prophet. It's not an either. It's not an or, it is a both and. It is an affirmation that at the core of his task, of the task of Jesus, at the center of his march to Jerusalem, is prayer, and it is what I would call compassionate ministry. And to some extent, Luke wants to correct some of what he sees as where Mark doesn't quite get it right. I mean, in Mark, you have a lot of stories about Jesus, sometimes as an exorcist, healing the leper, doing great, great healing ministry, you could say, in the Gospel of Mark. In Matthew, you have Jesus presented as rabbi. In fact, the word rabbi is said over and over again in the Gospel of Matthew. And Luke is saying, yes, both of those are right. And I'm not, and Jesus is not going to affirm one of those perspectives over the others. Trying to remember, see if I can remember this line from a Bob Dylan song. Does anybody remember Bob Dylan besides me? You don't need to be a weatherman to know which way the wind blows. Do you remember that? And I always, when I heard Bob Dylan sing that song and say that line, you don't need to be a weatherman to know which way the wind blows, I think of this verse. I think about Jesus saying, you know, telling the weather is one thing, but knowing the time, that really is important for this task, this call, this vocation. And it's still our vocation today. We might say it's important to know how to prognosticate, like that word out, prognosticate, right? The television is full of talking heads, right? Pundits who prognosticate. They can read the polls, they can read surveys, but very few are able to know the times. And I think this is where the church has so much to contribute. Because here I think we know the times, we know the feel. We have a sense of presence, present times. One of my heroes in the 20th century is Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and I just want to sort of close today by just talking a little bit about how I think Dietrich Bonhoeffer displays what Jesus is talking about in the passage this morning. Bonhoeffer was one of the great minds in really the our tradition. And he was taught by one of the greatest theologians, maybe in the last 500 years, right? Not as good as Martin Luther, but Karl Barth's up there, right? And Bonhoeffer was a student of Barth, and Barth read his dissertation and said, this is a miracle, right? And Bonhoeffer began his ministry early in life, and he was a committed pacifist. He wanted to start a new seminary that would be committed to teaching these principles and these ideas. When Hitler came to power, Bonhoeffer went on the radio and denounced him. And before he could finish, they shut off the radio. And he was not allowed to speak in that fashion again. He later on traveled to the United States. He was at the United States, lived in the United States for a time. He lived in New York and Harlem. And he said that the African-American church in Harlem really taught him what it meant to be a Christian. And he went on a famous bus trip, traveled from New York down to Mexico, and visited many destitute and impoverished communities. And he said later on that that also had a lasting effect on him. When he went back to Germany in 1937, his seminary was shut down. His way of really earning a living and his whole career was pretty much done for at that point. So he was invited to come back to New York and teach at one of the great seminaries of New York, of the United States, the Union Theological Seminary. And he went and he was seriously considering to take the position in New York. The last 1939, the summer of 39, Bonhoeffer decided he had to go back. He had to go back and be in solidarity with his community and with his people. He said to himself, how can I be a part? Eventually this war will come to an end and we will have to rebuild. How can I be a part of rebuilding my community if I'm not with our people through the mercy of God? So he chose to be in solidarity, even though he didn't have to, and even at some risk. He held on to his principles of pacifism. But I have to say this too. So in a way, let me just reiterate, Bonhoeffer then exemplifies this undergoing of fire, right? This undergoing of time of trial. There are times like this, as I just described to you, where everything that we believe in, what we thought was right, seems to be tested. Right? The place where we thought was our place, we have to reevaluate and think about that and recommit ourselves exactly to the best of our ability. And I think that's what Jesus is talking about here. Sometimes we say, well, family is the most important thing, but then there are times of fire, right? And sometimes we know that families are torn apart for different reasons. There's a church I visited in southern Illinois. I won't even say the town where it was. But they had stained glass windows like we have here, and I was just thinking of that even now. And I remember seeing up on the stained glass window two Civil War soldiers on either side of the window. And one was in a blue uniform, and the other was in a gray uniform. And I asked about that. I remember asking about that, and they said, yeah, that's right. So the families in this church fought on both sides of the Civil War. And I think in Bonhoeffer's time, there's something like that fire, right? There's something like that time of division and purification and reevaluation that is called for. This is what Jesus is talking about as he's on his way to Jerusalem. It's a time for prayer, the priestly tradition. It's also a time to remember the prophetic past, the solidarity with the marginalized, the voiceless, that really is at the heart and the core of what Jesus was about. And it is what Luther called the theology of the cross. Right? That which unites all four of these diverse gospels is the theology of the cross. The theology of the cross is to view the world from the perspective of the cross, from the perspective of the innocent who have been executed wrongly, from the perspective of those who have been not only marginalized, but shut out and not listened to. Let me close with this quote from Bonhoeffer, that our task is continually to be prepared to be interrupted by God. To be prepared to be interrupted by God. The task is to question everything that we are from the perspective of God. And that is prayer for Bonhoeffer, and that, I think, is what Jesus is speaking about in our passage this morning. To be prepared to be interrupted by God. It would be nice if life was not interrupted, right? It was all just sort of one happy time. But our call this morning is